Welcome everybody to our online seminar series on machine learning needs mathematical optimization. So today we have the pleasure of having Isabel Valera, who is full professor on machine learning at the Department of Computer Science of Saarland University in Germany. She's also an adjunct faculty at the Max Planck Institute for Software Systems in Saarbrücken. Isabel works on probabilistic models, machine learning, and her presentation today is about ethics in machine learning. She has a PhD from Universidad Carlos III in Madrid, and she has been in postdoctoral positions in Cambridge and the Max Planck Institute, and she has also led a group in the intelligent system in Tübingen, Max Planck Institute in Germany. So it's a great pleasure to have you today here talking about such an important topic in machine learning. Thank you very much, Isabel, for accepting our invitation, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for inviting me to be here, and sorry for somehow the technical issues from before. So as Dolores was mentioning before, today we are going to talk about machine learning, and in particular we are going to talk about ethics in machine learning, specifically about fairness and interpretability. But as we will see later, we are going to put the focus on assumptions. So let me start with a bit of introduction to give you context. So in today's talk, we are going to focus on one particular application of machine learning, which is decision making. And in general, I call it a consequential decision making because the decisions that machine learning, these machine learning algorithms that we are going to talk about today, may have consequences in the life of the individuals that they decide about. And when we talk about algorithmic decision making, of course, basically we are going to restrict ourselves today to decision making systems where the decision is made by the algorithm, but they can also be supporting human decision makers, although this is out of the scope of today. And as I mentioned today, before, we are going to talk about ethics. So in general, the question that arises when we are applying machine learning to make decisions, for example, about whether we grant pretrial bail to an inmate, or whether we grant a loan, or whether we hire someone, is how to make sure that these systems or the outcomes of these systems are actually aligned with the society or human goals and values. And of course, if you think of different humans and the decision-making systems that we encounter, different people may have different goals. So for example, if you think of the deployer of this algorithmic decision-making system, maybe they might be mostly interested in maximizing the accuracy of these systems, or at the end of the day, maximizing the profit that they get, while if we go to the justice system or regulators, they might be more interested in checking whether the algorithm in place actually fulfills existing laws, for example, discrimination laws. Or if we go one level even to the end, what we can think of is of the individuals that these algorithms are going to make decisions about, and they might be interested in understanding why a particular decision was made and how to change it. For example, in the hiring process, if you apply for a position and the algorithm filters you out, so you don't get interview or you don't get the position, maybe you might be interested in understanding why and how can you act upon so that next time you apply for a job, you get it. So in this context is where we are gonna focus. And just to give you a bit of more context on the technical assumptions that usually we make when we apply machine learning for decision making, is that in general, what we have is some historical data where we collect some information in the form of features about candidates. So let's assume here that we have loan applicants, and we collect some information about them, like their income, credit card history, previous loans. And In general, we are going to refer to this set of features as non-sensitive, but on the top of that, we are going to have another set of features, which we call sensitive features, and might be the gender or the race of individuals that historically have been considered sensitive features by anti-discrimination laws. So what exactly a sensitive feature is depends on the scenario and also depends on the law that applies in this particular context. But in general, discrimination laws, for example, divide usually consider protected and non-protected groups. And together with these sensitive features, we have access to some outcome information on whether each of these applicants fully paid the loan that they were granted or default in repay. And the whole point of applying machine learning algorithms here is that observe the historical data that we have on the top. Basically, we are interested in making decisions for a new applicant for which we only see this set of features, but we want to predict or to inform a decision on whether to grant, in this particular case here, the loan or not based on our prediction about the outcome. And this is where the machine learning comes in, where basically we use all this data from before to train a new an algorithm that basically from a new applicant, they take the data and can predict whether it fully pays or not. And based on that prediction, we might decide to grant or not the loan. So this is the context that we are gonna focus on. And as I mentioned before, we will be talking mostly about fairness and interpretability. So simply to give you a high level definition of what we are gonna consider for each of these terms, basically in general, when we talk about fairness, most of the times I will be referring to discrimination or unfairness and discrimination. And basically what we are gonna aim is that the outcomes of these machine learning algorithms do not systematically differ or impose a disadvantage on individuals belonging to different social salient groups. And as I said before, what a different social salient group is depends on whether you share some particular sensitive feature with the group. And when we are going to be talking about interpretability, in particular, going to be referring to explainability, which is going to be defined as the ability to explain the outcomes of such an algorithm in understandable ways to a human. So, of course, these two definitions are very high level, and there is a lot of literature on how to provide, enforce fairness and interpretability of these systems. Actually, if we look a bit in detail on some of the number of papers that have been published or submitted recently in top-tier conferences of machine learning, we can see that basically the growth is exponential. In where basically they propose new approaches to ensure fair and interpretable machine learning. But in today's talk, I'm not gonna directly focus on how to provide mechanisms or definitions for these two notions, but rather I'm gonna talk about the technical assumptions that we often do in machine learning, and in particular in fair and interpretable machine learning, and how our assumptions, if not made carefully, may come up with a high social cost. And here by social cost in general, I'm gonna think of the impact that it has in fairness and interpretability. So this is gonna be our content, and I'm gonna basically give you two examples of the societal cost of assumptions. And the first one is gonna be in the context of fair machine learning. And just as a spoiler, what we are gonna see is that when we make wrong technical assumptions, in general, what we are gonna or may have as a result is that we will be amplifying the unfairness that we already see in society and therefore in the data. So to go a bit more in detail, here we have again our our definition or a different version of this discrimination. And just as a recall, everything that machine learning sees about every individual is going to be classified or separated into two set of features, some that are non-sensitive, as we saw before, and some other sensitive features that basically tells you what social group they belong to. And given that, what it has been shown in the context of fair decision-making systems is that the optimal policy to make decisions about individuals is to pick a policy that basically maps features into decisions. And here we are assuming binary decisions, so I grant or the bank grants or doesn't grant the loan. So this is what we have by V equal one. And these are the set of non-sensitive and sensitive features. So the optimal policy to make such a decision is a deterministic threshold policy, which decides, yes, loan granted, if the probability of the individual repaying the loan, this is P of y equal one is repaying the loan, is greater or equal than the cost of granting the loan. This C is a constant that is between zero and one in general in this type of models, and usually account for some economics interest from the bank in our case. And if we want to account for some fairness, or we want to do some fairness corrections to this optimal decision policy, we can change this threshold to accommodate for different groups. So we could make this C to depend also on the sensitive feature. So this is what, in the general case, in binary decision-making systems, the optimal decision-making rule would be. But of course, something to keep in mind is that here, when I talk about the probability of this individual repaying the loan, in general, what the main assumption is here is that this probability is the true probability of someone repaying the loan. But you can imagine that when I go to the bank and apply for a loan, I don't come with like a label here that says, this is my probability of repaying the loan. So this is where the machine learning comes in. And in practice, what people have been doing, and this is why there is so much work on fairness in prediction models, is that we train a predictive model using historical data, as I showed you before, that basically approximates this true probability of someone repaying the loan, of course, up to some mismatch. And this mismatch hopefully is going to go to zero as we collect more data. When something to keep in mind, and the assumption that we are going to question today, is actually whether the predictive model or the predictive setting, where we basically try to make a predictive model that fits this true probability, is the right setting. Because there is an underlying assumption in this setting, which is that our label data, this historical data I showed you before that were showing a set of features and outcomes, whether someone repaid or didn't repay the loan, is under the assumption that the data that we collected, the training data, is IID samples from the ground truth distribution. So if that is the case, everything, as you will see, will go well, because basically we assume that we have an underlying true distribution P from which we sample this tuple of non-sensitive features, sensitive features, and outcomes. We train a predictive model that tries to get a Q approximation of the true probability. Sometimes, instead of making the correction in C, we can also train this predictive model to already account for some fairness constraints that basically can make sure that our predictions on the Ys fulfill the same true positive rates, for example, across groups. That would be equal opportunity in the fairness literature. And in general, what we do is that we use this approximation of the true distribution to make decisions. So in practice, what we have is that rather than having this deterministic optimal threshold policy, what we have is an approximated one that makes decision one if our prediction about an individual repaying the loan is greater than a threshold. the problem or the assumption that we have been making for very, very long time is that actually the data that we had was representative of these true P population, so it was IID, and therefore we could train this Q such that asymptotically, as we collected more data, it would perfectly fit the true distribution, or the mismatch would be very, very small. The problem that was pointed out a bit more recently in the literature is that is where we actually collect the data from. So if you think of our example on the loan applications, what we have is that basically the applicants that come to the bank, they might be an IEID sample from the true applicants, but in general, how we collect the labels, the outcomes, is by a policy that the bank has there, because which is this by zero. Because only if we grant the loan to someone, which is we make decision one, we can check or we can observe if this applicant will fully repay the loan or will default. In contrast, if this by zero, this policy, decision-making policy that was in place during the data collection, decides that an applicant is not going to be granted the loan, then we don't get to observe whether it would repay or not. And that is already telling you that basically the data distribution that we have, or the distribution that we have in our data, doesn't need to fully match the true underlying distribution of X, S, and Y that I call P before, but instead it might be induced by the policy that was used during the data collection process, because we are only gonna see the labels for those people that we granted the loan. So it doesn't really matter whether this PI was an algorithm or was a human being, but as we will see later, in general, only under very specific assumptions, this P by zero is gonna correspond to the true population that we will be applying the loan to. This is the problem that is called usually selective labels problem, because we have a policy which actually selects which labels, for which people we are gonna reveal or not the label. So unfortunately, when we made this assumption explicit, which is not that making the assumptions of standard predictive models explicit in our decision-making framework, what we found out is that as long as this initial pi zero policy is different from the optimal policy, the one that we use for collecting the data differs from the optimal one that we are targeting to, basically thresholding a predictive model trained on this data collected from pi zero is always gonna be suboptimal. And what I mean here by suboptimal, basically what I mean is that I'm not gonna not only achieve the best performance for the bank in terms of utility, but we are also gonna be suboptimal into fairness. And this is what we are gonna see in a second, because we will see that when we do these two steps by first predicting and then deciding based on a predictive model trained on data from a different policy, what we might have is that we might be amplifying fairness. So in order to overcome this situation, actually what we need to do is to move away from something that we love in machine learning, which is making predictions. And instead, what we need to learn is directly to decide rather than to predict. So instead of directly making first a prediction and then deciding, we are gonna need to train directly decision policies. And it is not enough to learn any decision policy, but these decision policies are gonna need to satisfy a set of some properties, which is basically the fact that they cannot put zero probability of granting the loan to an individual as long as this individual belongs to the true population. So it is plausible under the true population. That means this policy that we can train cannot ignore any part of the input space. That means that definitely policies which are deterministic threshold rules cannot be applied, because basically they deterministically make decision zero for a part of the population. And the fact that we have zero observations for these people, because if we never grant a subset of the population the loan, we are never going to be able to reveal whether they would repay or not, then basically we won't be able to have or to recover towards the optimal distribution. So to be a bit more illustrative here, what it happened is that imagine that we are going to do sequential policy learning, where basically every iteration, let's say every year, the bank is going to train a new policy based on the data that he has, that the bank has for, from previous year. And if we do the two steps policy learning, first this prediction, and then thresholding this prediction to make decisions, while this procedure may in principle mimic the optimal policy, because of the way the data has been collected, what it happens is that if we look at the optimal, imagine that this is the optimal profit that the bank could get for the, oops, I don't know what happened. For the true population, basically what we are going to have is that we are going to be suboptimal. And it's not only that, but also if we look at the unfairness level, in this particular case, we measure a disparity in true positive rates, which is equal opportunity. What we observe is that if the optimal policy, which I haven't corrected for any unfairness, has a level of unfairness of a bit above 0.06, so 6%, in when we train first a predictor and then threshold it, what we will be doing would be to amplify the unfairness that we already have in the data and in the optimal algorithm. So we would be suboptimal in, for the bank, but also have a bad societal impact by amplifying fairness. In contrast, if we do what we said, we learn directly to decide by having these what we call exploring policies, which simply means that they put a probability of granting the loan to any individual, which is greater than zero. It can be arbitrarily small, but at least greater than zero, so that once in a while we reveal what the label is. Basically, we asymptotically can converge towards the optimal policy, not only on profit for the bank, but also on the fairness level. So this was the first example I wanted to mention, and this was in the context of fairness. But we are going to see next that similar assumptions that we have made in the literature of explainable machine learning may also have undesirable consequences for the individuals that these algorithms apply to. And in particular, what we are going to show is that the wrong assumptions that we make may ask for too much effort or even useless effort from individuals that want to change an unfavorable outcome. That means if an individual applied for a loan, he didn't get the loan and may wonder how to act in order to get the loan, we might be asking for too much effort in order to change their outcome, or even useless effort, because even if they would do it, they wouldn't get what they are seeking for. So to be more specific, in this context, we are going to be focusing on a particular part of explainable machine learning, which aims to answer the question I was mentioning before, where we say, why didn't I get the loan? What should I do next time I apply? And actually, a way of answering the first question here, why I didn't get the loan, it is what we usually call a counterfactual explanation. And what should I do in order to get it next time I apply? It is what we call algorithmic recourse. Basically, algorithmic recourse gives you an idea of what to do in order to change a situation or a decision, in our case, made by an algorithm. So the answer that the ML or explainable ML system would give this individual would be, you were denied the loan because your salary was $25,000. If your salary would increase to 30K, you will get granted the loan. So these are the kind of decisions that, that we have been looking for, and actually how this turns out. Sorry, I have a lot of background noise. They decided to start construction next to my house. Basically, what we have is that this finding this algorithmic recourse turns out to be phrased or formulated as an optimization problem, where basically what we can find is to what we want aim to find is that we want to find the minimum at around the cost. So this is the cost of the actions that the individual will make. The individual that is looking for recourse is the factual individual, usually called the factual individual. And then we have over X, which is the resulting individual that after performing an action would result, subject to the output to the classifier, which I make here HX is equal 1. So here we assume that the prediction is positive. And we are restricting ourselves to binary predictions simply for simplicity. So this is the how this problem has been formulated. But to be a bit more explicit, we have here Edward, which has two features. And basically, what this optimization problem is looking is for a counterfactual version of Edward that would end up in the other side of the classification boundary and incurs the minimum cost for Edward to become that individual. And the assumption that has been made mostly in the literature, sorry, I'm gonna close the window quickly. Oh God, I hope it's better. Is that actually how we go from Edward to the new version of Edward, the counterfactual version of Edward, is in an independent way. So it means that we can basically manipulate the features, or we can act on the features of Edward to result in the counterfactual. So this is why here we say if we change X2, we would end up on the top counterfactual Edward. If we would manipulate X1, then we would end up here, and basically everything that involves manipulating or acting on any of the two features would end up somewhere here. But basically what we assume is that the final value, the counterfactual value of every feature that we have, for example, we can say I can act on my salary without acting on my income, my savings. This is the main assumption that we are making, or in the other way around. So for example, if the main assumption is that if your salary is increased from 25K to 30K, you haven't changed your savings. That is the main assumption. This assumption has been made in the explanations for algorithmic recourse, but also in fairness related definitions, which, for example, there is fairness by equalizing recourse that basically aim to equalize the average cost or distance, in this case, of recourse across protected groups. So if you would compute the recourse, the minimum recourse cost for every individual, for example, for females and males, what fairness by equalizing recourse papers try to do is to minimize the difference between the recourse cost for the males compared to the females, or keep it below a threshold epsilon. So basically everything I want to convey here is that at the moment we make an assumption, which is that we can independently act on each of the features. We are not only affecting the algorithmic recourse, which aims to fulfill an explanation, an actionable explanation, but also if later on we use this definition of recourse or these assumptions to fairness, it is always going to be there. And the problem of this assumption, where, as I mentioned, we were assuming that we can intervene or act in each of the individual features in an independent way, that is why I also call it independent world assumption, is that unfortunately, this assumption doesn't guarantee recourse. So I can solve the previous optimization problem and get a set of actions, but that is never gonna guarantee, or at least not in standard assumptions that that recourse is achieved. And even if the actions that they recommend are feasible and trigger Edward to the other side of the boundary, they might be suboptimal. So I might be asking the individual for too much effort in order to change their decision. And that has a very simple explanation at the moment as we look at this graph, and it is that the fact that we are assuming that the features characterizing Edward, they are independent on each other. So that means the salary of Edward and his savings are independent on each other. But we all know that this is not the case. So at the moment, we assume that we can capture the dependencies between these features using a causal model, saying, for example, my salary affects my savings. It is well known that people seeking for a house, for example, save 30% of their salary when possible. And maybe there's another feature. It is very easy to see that if I change my salary, I will increase my savings, and I might be able to cross the boundary with less effort than if I assume that I need to only act on my salary. So that is a bit of a bad result, but because basically everything we are saying is that, okay, we have formalized the algorithmic recourse problem as an optimization problem, but because of the assumptions that we are making about the features, basically everything that is coming out of this optimization problem doesn't provide you any guarantees. So we are giving an explanation, but it is not very clear how useful that explanation is going to be for the individual at the end of the day, because it might ask for useless effort or for too much effort. So the question that we wonder is, can we guarantee recourse? Unfortunately, I have another negative result, which is that actually, if we really want to guarantee recourse, mean we want to give you a set of actions that deterministically will take you to the other side of the boundary with minimum cost, this can only be achieved if we know the true causal model underlying our data distribution. And what does it mean? Actually, that means knowing what the how the relationship between the features, which features are causally dependent on other. For example, your savings might be causally dependent on the salary. But not only knowing this causal graph on who depends, which variable depends on which one and how, but also you need to know exactly how. You also need to know the structural causal equations, which is what I'm trying to show here with these expressions, that basically tells you how you go from noise to X1, from X1 and some additional noise to X2 and so on and so forth. And you need to know that for all the variables that you have collected to train your model. Unfortunately, this is quite unrealistic. And while under some assumptions you might be able to recover this causal graph using domain expert, for example, in social science, they often have causal models or stipulate some causal models for some application domains, for example, in economy. In general, the assumptions that we can make here are actually unstable. And in general would require counterfactual data. That means we would need to intervene on this causal graph to confirm them. So while in machine learning, we would have some tendency to say, okay, I know the parametric form of these assumptions and I use the collected data to fit the parameters of these different functions. That unfortunately in general is not possible, because if we get by any means wrong, this is the shape of this functions, basically we will be under an imperfect knowledge of causal model, and at the moment this is imperfect. Again, we will be in the original case where recourse is not guaranteed by any means. So this is a bit of, again, quite some negative results, but I have some good news, because the question is that, can we achieve recourse under realistic assumptions? That mean, okay, you told us that you need full causal knowledge, but of course having full causal knowledge, you just said that is impossible? And I would say yes and no. So you can definitely achieve recourse, but you can achieve recourse in a probabilistic way under milder causal assumptions. So in particular, what we have done is to relax our assumptions on the causal model and assume that we know the causal graph, but maybe we don't need to know the structural equations, which is the harder part to estimate. And if this is the case, what I actually can achieve is what we call probabilistic algorithmic recourse. Basically, you won't be able to say, okay, if you increase your salary by 5,000, you will get recourse. But what you can say is that if you increase your salary by 14% or 5,000, your savings are also expected to grow proportionally. And as a consequence, you will get the loan with 90% or 0.9 probability. That is what you can do. And the question is, I just said that we can relax these assumptions. And what we did more recently in our last NeurIPS paper was to come up with two different approaches to relax these assumptions. So in the first one, basically, and this is, I'm gonna cover at a very high level, but I'm happy to discuss further technical details. What we are gonna assume is that our structural equations, if we assume that they are smooth, and we assume that our noise variables are Gaussian, additive Gaussian variables, then what we can do is to integrate out the exact parametric form of the structural equation by using a Gaussian process prior that basically plays a prior over an infinite space of smooth functions. And in that case, what we will have is that if we have here Edward, basically we will map Edward into a cloud, into a whole population that would be with probability 90% on the other side of the boundary. And the fact that there is a cloud instead of a single point here is because we have uncertainty on the actual structural equations. Of course, you might argue still that maybe having additive Gaussian noise doesn't sound very plausible when you are talking about salary and income, or even worse, if you are talking about features that don't even need to be real valued, like age. So what we did was to come up with even a more relaxed setting where we said, okay, maybe we only need access to the causal graph, no assumptions on the noise, not assumptions on the structural equations. We still assume that there is causal sufficiency, not very important, but for those people familiarized with the causal literature, that means that there are non-confounders in our causal graph. And instead, what we can do is that we can approximate the interventional distribution. And that simply means that we are going to work not at the individual level of Edward, but at a subpopulation of people that look similar to like Edward. And basically it says for people like Edward, which are in the negative side of the boundary, if they perform that action, they cross the boundary with X percent probability. And how we do that? In our particular case, we use a bunch of conditional variation autoencoders or regression models in general to fit relationship between parents and children in our causal graph. But I believe there are many other ways. So without going into much more details than that, let me use maybe my last 3-4 minutes to have some wrap up. And if you didn't follow completely all the technical details of the talk, maybe, but there is some messages that you should take home today. Basically, I would like to argue that even before we start thinking of adding ethical constraints to our machine learning algorithms, the first thing that we need to question is the assumptions that we have made for the algorithm design, but also for the algorithms that we are going to use to enforce fairness or to ensure interpretability. Because as we have seen before today, basically when we make wrong assumptions on each of these steps, what it may happen is that we end up having a high social cost. And this is what I tried to convey when I saw this plot, where that basically, because we did the wrong assumptions on the data collection process, basically we were amplifying unfairness. So for people that maybe they are already in a disadvantaged group, now they are affected by an algorithm that is making the situation even worse because it is amplifying this unfairness that already exists structurally in society. And when we later on try to help these individuals by giving them an explanation saying, well, you didn't get what you wanted, you didn't get the job, but if you do this, you will get it. But in the way we generate this explanation, we again do the wrong assumptions. Basically, we might require too much effort to people that are already in an unfavorable situation, or even worse, we can ask them for useless effort just because we were not careful enough at making our assumptions explicit. That is the first message, but something that I hope it was clear throughout the talk is that basically your assumptions cover the whole machine learning pipeline from, and they definitely start with the data collection process. So we have seen today how important it is to know which features we are collecting, whether the data that we collect actually come from the true population that we will apply the algorithm, what are the causal relationships between these features. As I saw here, it's very important to later on being able to actually provide explanations to individuals. So basically, when we start the whole process, we need to start from the very beginning with the assumption, because how well or what we can do afterwards is going to definitely depend on the data collection process. But this is definitely not the only assumptions that we need to look at. Beyond that, of course, our machine learning models in general, they work or they are designed to work under some particular assumptions that might not be particularly realistic. But what we, or in my case, maybe this is because I'm tailored and used to probabilistic approaches, what I found out is that actually probabilistic approaches may help you to relax these assumptions. So first you make clear what the assumptions of your algorithm is making, and you try to see whether these assumptions fulfill in reality. If they don't, then you need to find a way of relaxing these assumptions in your algorithm, given that you cannot change how the world behaves. And in my case, one way of accounting for uncertainty in my assumptions, but doesn't need to be the only way, is the probabilistic pipeline. And we have seen that by basically making our decision policies, algorithmic decision policies, somehow more probabilistic, or making sure that the distribution that they induced puts a positive density over all the population. But we have also seen that by giving explanations, which rather than being deterministic are probabilistic. And finally, something I would like to mention and comes back to the assumptions is that basically it is essential to have a holistic view of the world. And it's not only about how to solve the problem, how to collect the data, but also whether you actually want to do this algorithm. So to give you an example, there was this open letter from last summer where basically different researchers were sending a request to the Springer editor because there was a paper that was about to get published in the Springer, in one of the Springer journals, about how to predict criminal risk from face images. So basically they were saying, well, we can predict what is your criminal risk based on your picture. And don't worry, we are not unfair because we have incorporated some demographic parity, some fairness constraints according to whatever notion in whatever paper. But of course, that is not the point. The point is whether it at all makes sense to classify people in criminal or not criminal based on their faces. If you ask me, I would say no. I guess this is up to discussion for society, but everything I mean to say is that, well, before you even start having the algorithm, make sure that actually what you are trying to solve makes sense ethically. So the ethics comes from even before you even start thinking of an algorithm or collecting data, but they come from whether such an algorithm should exist in society. And with that, I would like to conclude. I hope I am fine with time and I'm happy to take questions.
Isabel, thank you so much for your talk. I think it's very important, your whole theme, but especially what you just said about, you know, defining, you know, the problems that we want to analyze through machine learning. Thank you so much. And we had a question from David. David, if
can you hear me?
Can you hear me? Yes, we can hear you.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Thank you very much for the talk. Very interesting. So this might be related to your no confounder assumption, but you know, often I think maybe one of the problems the bank is facing when it's evaluating someone, whether they'll pay back the loan or not, is whether that person is a particular type of person. And you know, I don't necessarily have data on their type. I have data on other characteristics. So could it be the case that once someone knows the rules about how the, you know, the algorithm works, they actually will change their behavior in such a way that the rules would no longer be a good predictor of whether someone is likely or unlikely to pay back the loan?
Yeah, that is a very good point, very good question. That is also where I wanted to convey when I didn't enter really much there, but this is a potential feedback loop, right? That you deploy an algorithm and then people react to that. And how do you make sure that your algorithm is optimal or fair in this whole closed loop, right? So precisely these closed loops is something that people have started recently looking at under the literature of how to be optimal in under strategic behavior. And this is why it is so important to actually zoom out from your algorithm and data and optimization objective, whatever, right? And say, hey, does it make sense? Do I have a feedback loop anywhere? And this is definitely one of those that are being approached. And once you do that and under some assumptions, you can place things as a game between two agents, the algorithm and the individuals, and you can at least try to react to how people will act, or if you do it sequentially, you can keep adapting to that. But basically that comes back to the assumptions, right? Because there is a feedback loop to consider. Because you are giving explanations so they get a better understanding, they can strategically change. In the case of loan, I mean, it's kind of hard to strategically change your, without lying, your salary and your information, but definitely it is something to consider.
Sure, but I mean, you might have an underlying type, right? Likely to pay, like, you know, a lying type or like honest type or something. And, you know, the honest people might, or the lying people might take advantage, but yeah.
I mean, definitely the only, everything I tried to mention there is that basically in this kind of context, there is a legal background that says, well, if you lie, you might get very lucky, but I mean, you are doing already something like illegal. There are other cases where really the whole distribution shape, because the underlying population evolves over time to adapt towards this decision-making system. In any case, I believe it's important that we keep in mind these feedback loops.
Thank you very much. Is there any other question from the audience? Isabel, I was thinking that you had this picture of, well, you grant the loan or not. So there is the decision that basically the decision maker is making. Can you tell us whether there are already papers on say, a larger complexity of this decision process? So in that case, it was, yeah, say, our decision tree with a yes or no. Are you aware of more complex decision processes being incorporated into this important topic?
So I would say most of the work on consequential decision making has restricted themselves to the binary case, where under this very simplistic this like utility for the owner and very simplistic definition of fairness. More recently, there are a couple of papers that extend that to say, well, maybe we have more than one agent and there is a regulator and there is a welfare function on the top of that and you want to optimize for both. That is on the case of decision making, and definitely in other contexts there has been a bit of literature of fair ranking, for example, or more and more people are looking also at systems where maybe the final decision is not made by the algorithm, but the algorithm is informing a final human decision maker and how this interaction is. So basically I would say most of the fairness literature, at least initially, we've restricted ourselves a lot on the predictive, very like simplistic setting, and eventually definitely we are opening up. I guess we just need to be a bit careful or make a bit of a bigger effort on being more explicit about our assumptions. Like, we are not very good in machine learning at making our assumptions sometimes very, very explicit. I guess it is in the context where machine learning applies or interact with humans, it becomes very essential to make them much more explicit, simply because they will have an impact to people.
That's very important. Is there any other question from the audience? So I guess David has another question. Go ahead, David.
I'm sorry, but I did. It was just so interesting that I have one more question about the first part of the paper, actually. So so you mentioned that the data that comes out of the bank's decisions, it's not representative of the whole sort of distribution, because the bank already made a decision. So you kind of have a filter there already before you get the data. So have you guys considered modeling that decision? In which case you could kind of undo the bank's decision and get back to kind of the underlying data.
I mean, we did some work into that direction. It is a bit complicated at times. So in our case, what we did was exactly in the other way around. So we said, well, if we have a group of decision makers, like judges, and you need to assign cases to judges, how do we do the matching between them so that the overall system is somehow accurate and fair? And therefore, there was a bit of an implicit prediction on what their preferences or biases could be, whether they were harsher or more lenient, or whether they have some bias towards some groups. That is definitely the case that we did. Somehow, once you are giving with the data, in general, maybe we need to collect that information, because right now, how the data sets that we have access to, they don't collect even this information. We don't know whether, so it's very hard. The good part of doing algorithmic decision making is that if you keep the policy, you can check with which probability they make every decision, but definitely, and you can correct for whatever bias the system has, but you cannot directly so easily quantify that when it is humans, or you would need a lot of more information. So in the algorithmic system, everything or correcting for biases is much easier, because basically you know the certainty which the algorithm makes a decision. But if you translate that to humans, that we are a bit lost in that direction. We can try to approximate, but not as easy as we would like it to be.
Thank you again. Is there any other question from the audience? Otherwise, I think we would like to thank you for your very impressive talk. I think it's one of the things that we like to talk about in this online seminar series, so how we can make more explicit what it can be done and what it cannot be done in machine learning, because it has an impact on the citizen. And it was great to have your models here, destroying some ideas and constructing other ones. Thank you.
Thank you very much for inviting me to be here.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. And we will see each other on Monday with some machine learning models for energy. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.